Actually, the real crash came out a year ago. But actually, it's still number one in economics and investing on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. So it's still selling. Paul Krugman's book now isn't even in the top 100. His book came out the same time as mine. Now, they only gave me, I think, 25 minutes to talk. And if you know me, I have a hard time speaking for just 25 minutes. So if you want to get the rest of the story, I'm going to be in this room tomorrow, I think, at 11:15. Now, you know, it's kind of like, for me, it's deja vu all over again. You know, I know it's 2013, but it feels a lot like 2006. You know, by the way, Charles, those slides that you use, where's Charles? I don't know, but those charts were left over from 2006. Maybe he changed a couple of the numbers, but it really feels like 2006. Now, why does it feel like 2006? Well, think back. I mean, I know for the average professional trader, this is like ancient history, but it wasn't that long ago. And in 2006, we were about 5 or 6 years subsequent to the bursting of the stock market bubble. But no one cared. It was great because stock prices were rising again. Real estate prices were rising. Everyone thought it was great, except it wasn't great. Right? Right around the corner lay the biggest financial crisis since the Great Depression. But in 2006, they were partying like it was 1999. Well, here it is, 2013. We're about 6 years after the bursting of the stock market bubble, bigger bubble than the real estate bubble. But no one cares because the stock market is rising again and the real estate market is rising again, so everything is great, except it's not. It's actually worse than it was, I think, in 2006. Go back and think, why was the stock market going up? Why were real estate prices rising back then? It was because of the Fed stimulus. It was cheap money that we used to revive the economy subsequent to the downturn in 2001 when the stock market bubble burst. So it was a Fed-induced phony recovery. It was a bubble, except very few people recognized the fact that it was a bubble. So they were surprised. They didn't read my book, so they were surprised by what happened in 2008. But here we are. The market is rallying for the exact same reason. The stock market, the real estate market are going up because of cheap money. In fact, the money's even cheaper now than it ever was in the prior bubble. And what's even more amazing is these same experts that couldn't see this crisis coming when it should have been obvious, they now will admit that the Fed is behind the recovery, that the market is going up because of the Fed, that the real estate market is going up by the Fed. Even the Fed admits it this time, which is interesting because when you talk to the Fed or if anyone from the Fed speaks, they always say that their cheap money policies had nothing to do with the rise of real estate prices prior to 2008. But apparently those same policies are why real estate prices are rising today. But all these experts are telling us, yes, we know the Fed is doing the same thing to solve the problem that it did to create the problem. But this time it's different. This time it's going to end well. Right? Because now, that's probably, I think, from an investor's point of view, probably one of the most dangerous phrases you can utter is this time it's different. But they might actually be right. This time it is different because it's going to be a lot worse. You know, the last financial crisis, we caught a break, right? Because everybody ran towards the blast, even though it kind of began in the U.S., and stock prices went down and real estate prices went down. The dollar went up. The bond market went up. People rushed into dollars and treasuries as a safe haven asset. And that really benefited temporarily our economy because that's what mitigated rising consumer prices. It kept interest rates low. It financed all the bailouts. The government couldn't have done the bailouts and all the stimulus if treasury yields were rising and the dollar was tanking. So we got all this extra rope courtesy of the rest of the world. Unfortunately, you know, we didn't use it as a lifeline. We fashioned it into a noose. And we are going to end up hanging on that rope because the next crisis that is coming, And I don't know if it's going to start in 2013 or 2014. That smart I'm not. But I know it's coming. And I think it will be different from the last one, because I do think that the next time around, the world will be smart enough to dump the dollar and dump U.S. treasuries. And when that happens, the economic damage is going to be far greater than what happened in 2008. In fact, I've been talking about this real crash, which is the subject of that book, for a long time. In fact, the first book that I wrote, called Crash Proof, How to Profit from the Coming Economic Collapse, which came out in February of 07, which was mainly written by June 06, is when the book was pretty much finished. But when I wrote that book, and I wrote about the economic crash that was coming, it wasn't what happened in 2008. That was not what I was writing about. Now, I did cover all that. In that book, I went into detail about why we had this housing bubble, why the recovery was phony, that we were headed for the greatest recession since the Great Depression, that we would have double-digit unemployment and double-digit, trillion-dollar budget deficits. I wrote about all that, but that wasn't the economic collapse that the book was about. The collapse I was writing about was what was going to happen as a result of what we were going to do about that. See, my concern was not that we were going to die of that disease, but of the government's cure for that disease. And unfortunately, the government has done everything that I feared they would do when I originally wrote that book. And so now I think we are, waiting for the real crash. Now, there was an article that came out in the Wall Street Journal late on Friday. And they were talking about it all over the weekend this morning about how the Fed is now, got its exit strategy. It's got some kind of blueprint for an exit strategy. Well, I don't think the Fed has an exit strategy. I don't think exit is even possible. In fact, for years I've been saying that the Fed had checked into the Roach Motel of monetary policy. I mean, remember the last exit strategy when the Fed exited under Greenspan? Because Greenspan brought interest rates all the way down to 1%. Right? That was very low. At this point, we can't even afford interest rates as high as 1%. But back then, 1% was pretty low. And so Greenspan brought interest rates down to 1%. And he left them there for years, a couple years. And then the exit strategy was when they started raising rates in a measured pace. That was their exit strategy. They didn't raise interest rates quickly. They did it slowly. Now, why didn't they raise them quickly? Because if they had raised them quickly, the housing bubble would have burst in 2004 or 2005. They didn't want to prick the bubble. They wanted to nurture it. They wanted to postpone the consequences. So they exited slowly. And so the crash happened later, but because they exited so slowly, more air went into the bubble. I mean, most of the worst mortgages that were taken out during the housing bubble were taken out in 05 and 06. Had the Fed had a quicker exit, those mortgages never would have been originated, and so the financial crisis wouldn't have been as bad. But because they waited so long, because they were worried about, upsetting the phony recovery, we suffered. Well, where are we today? The U.S. economy, I would argue, is far more dependent on the Fed's cheap money than it ever was at any point prior. It's getting close to $17 trillion. Of course, that's just the tip of the iceberg. It doesn't count all the unfunded liabilities like Social Security, Medicare, or student loans, for example. There's now $1.1 trillion of student loan debt. And I don't know, if you've seen any of these students, but they ain't good for that money. Yeah. You got $100,000 in student loans and you majored in philosophy, you're not going to pay that loan back. So those are contingency liabilities. That they're not counted in the $17 trillion. So it's a joke. But even if you take that little teeny $17 trillion number, we're spending right now in interest on the national debt about $250 billion a year. Now that's how much we spent on interest on the national debt when Reagan was president. Now, how's that possible? Because the national debt then was tiny. It wasn't even $2 trillion, I think, in Reagan's last term. Now it's $17 trillion, but interest rates, our interest bill, rather, is the same. Well, this is because of 0% interest rates. It's because of QE. Now, what would happen if interest rates went back up to, I don't know, 5%, which is still lower than the historic average? And I would argue that interest rates need to go higher than 5%. They're much too low. The biggest problem with our economy is rates are too low. Right? The government is price-fixing interest rates, kind of the way the Soviet Union used to set the price of bread. That's how we determine interest rates, the price of money. And, of course, the whole economy is screwed up. So we're never going to have a real recovery until we have higher interest rates, which is why the economy can't recover as long as the Fed is stimulating it. Right? The stimulus is like a sedative. It's like pouring gasoline on a fire. The fire's not going to go out. It's just going to get bigger, which is why they have to keep putting on more stimulus. The problem is they never connect the dots. They never realize that the stimulus is the problem. Right? I mean, in Japan, they've been doing it for 20 years. And what did they just announce? Well, we're going to do it bigger. It hasn't worked yet, so we're going to do it. We're going to do it bigger. So they never learn from their mistakes. But if interest rates just go to 5%, and my math is not that great. So let's say it happens in another couple of years and the national debt's $20 trillion. Because 5% of $20 trillion is $1 trillion. I could do that easy. How are we going to get $1 trillion a year to pay the interest on the national debt? I mean, right now it's only $250 billion. That's an extra $750 billion. I mean, the sequester, everybody is screaming about the sequester, which is this tiny cut in the increase in government spending. This is like 20 sequesters, right? And that's just if interest rates go to 5%. What if they go to 10%? 10% would be $2 trillion in interest on the national debt. That would probably exceed what we would collect in taxes if interest rates were 10%. Now, people say, well, interest rates could never go to 10%. Why not? They went to 20%. When Volcker was there. So interest rates can rise. But the problem is, even a small rise in interest rates, I think, would derail the economy because the government could not afford it. It would either have to default on the debt or it would have to dramatically increase taxes or cut spending, things that are politically not going to be done. Interest rates go up. The banks are going to fail because of their leverage, because of the real estate assets on their books and long-term bonds. Even the Fed itself would basically be broke if interest rates rose, because the Fed now, you know, thanks to Operation Twist, which, you know, if you follow me, I've been calling it Operation Screw, but based on Operation Twist, right, the Fed now owns all the long-term bonds. So what happens when interest rates go up? What happens to the Fed's $3, $4, $5 trillion, who knows how big it's going to be by then. But what happens to their balance sheet when interest rates go up, right? The value of their bonds collapses. Hundreds of billions of dollars of losses for the Fed. Who's going to bail out the Fed? You know, right now, the Federal Reserve actually sends Congress a check because the Fed earns interest on all the bonds and mortgages that it owns, and it pays that interest to the government. Well, if interest rates go up, the Fed is going to have to send the Treasury a bill for its losses. Where are they going to get that money? And, of course, if interest rates go up and the Fed is tightening, which is, you know, And banks fail, because the next time when these big banks fail, it's not just going to be, you know, the shareholders that are in trouble, the bondholders, even the depositors are going to lose. Because if the Fed is tightening, it can't bail out anybody, right? Which is why I believe that there is no exit strategy. The Fed has to know this. So when it talks about an exit strategy, it's bluffing. It doesn't have a strategy. Exit is impossible. I mean, I've heard people say that, you know, it's going to be a difficult trick for the Fed to accomplish the exit from this strategy. It's not a difficult trick. I mean, a difficult trick would be pulling a tablecloth out from under the dishes without disturbing the dishes. What the Fed has to do is pull the table out from under the cloth and leave the dishes suspended in midair. It can't do that. See, People always use an analogy. They say it's like a bicycle. It's like the quantitative easing are the training wheels for the bike. And as soon as the bike gets enough momentum, we can take those training wheels off and we're going to keep on coasting, right? They're wrong, right? The quantitative easing, it's not the training wheels. They're the only wheels the bike has, right? Now, some people say, okay, fine, you know, just leave the wheels on. Don't take them off. Okay, the problem is the bike is headed for a cliff, right? So we have two choices. don't take the wheels off and go over the cliff, right? Or take the wheels off and we fall and maybe we get hurt, but we don't die because we avoid going over the cliff. Because that is what's going to happen if the Fed never takes away the stimulus. Because they will destroy the value of the dollar and they will destroy the bond market. And that is going to be a much worse economic crisis than the one that we had before. And you know, the bond market is probably the biggest Ponzi scheme that exists. And you know, one of the things that happened, and it kind of amazes me, is that the last time we had a debt ceiling crisis, and I'm sure there's another one looming, but the last big battle, which is how we got the sequester, by the way, but we had this battle over the debt ceiling. And if you remember, the President of the United States, the Secretary of the Treasury, the Chairman of the Federal Reserve, they all said that, well, if we don't raise the debt ceiling, we're going to default. They actually admitted that. And, you know, Ponzi schemes 101 is that when you're running a Ponzi scheme, you keep it quiet, right? You don't tell anybody about it. But that's what they did. Because we told the world, if we can't borrow more money, then we're not going to pay back the money that we already borrowed. See, that's a Ponzi scheme. We didn't say, well, we're going to raise taxes or we're going to cut government spending. They said, we're just not going to pay because we can't borrow more. That's a Ponzi scheme. In fact, when Bernie Madoff was when he was first put in jail, he was interviewed. And Bernie Madoff actually said, well, I mean, look, I mean, I'm nothing. The U.S. government is running the biggest Ponzi scheme ever. And I remember when that quote was in the newspapers because the reporters, everybody was saying, well, you know, he's Bernie Madoff. Who cares what he says? He doesn't have any credibility. Well, he's got credibility about one thing, Ponzi schemes. And that's why I remember at the time I was saying that, you know, why do we have Bernie Madoff in jail? We ought to make him Secretary of the Treasury. Because, I mean, he is uniquely qualified to be the Secretary of the Treasury. And think about this for a second. Why do we even call it the Secretary of the Treasury when we have no Treasury? It should be Secretary of the Debt, because that's all we have. And the job of the Secretary of the Treasury is to convince the world to keep lending us money, even though we're too broke to pay back the money that we already borrowed. But, you know, right now we're benefiting from the fact that people think that, you know, we're the best house on the block or in a bad neighborhood, because they look at Europe and they look at parts of Asia and they think we win by default. Even though we have bigger problems than the problems that people are worried about in Europe and Asia, but it doesn't matter because the dollar is still the reserve currency and people still have faith. And so, you know, we benefit from all these flows. In fact, you know, I hear a lot of, you know, politicians or sometimes people in the market, they'll blame our problems on Europe, right? Well, the truth is that the problems in Europe are like the best thing we got going for us right now. Because people are so afraid of Europe that they buy dollars and they buy treasuries, and so our markets are going up. But where would our markets be if we were looking at the same interest rates as Spain or Italy? Even though we have more debt than they do, you know, we're less creditworthy, but we borrow cheaper. Now, a lot of people think, well, you know, it's okay because we have a printing press, so you don't have to worry about default. Well, a printing press is not a get-out-of-jail-free card. You know, Zimbabwe has a printing press. That doesn't mean that their bonds should be rated AAA just because they can print. You know, I just read this article that there's actually a recovery going on in Zimbabwe now, that there's like 5 or 6% economic growth. And the reason for the recovery is that nobody is using the Zimbabwe money anymore. They now have a commerce in all kinds of other currencies, but the Zimbabwe currency is now no longer utilized, so the Zimbabwe government can no longer stimulate the economy. And so now it can grow. So, I mean, I hope we don't have to learn that entire lesson the hard way, but that, I think, is what is unfortunately likely to happen because, you know, I said we have this gigantic Ponzi scheme, right? We have the short-term debt. What is the Fed's exit strategy? Because if the first the Fed was saying that, well, you know, we're just going to unwind this balance sheet. We're going to sell off the bonds. Sell them to who? Is anyone in this room going to buy bonds when the Fed announces that they're selling? The Fed is the bond market. The only reason anyone's buying bonds is because they want to sell them to the Fed. Right? If the Fed says we want to sell, there's no buyers. The bottom drops out of the market. So then the Fed came out later and they've been saying, well, we don't actually have to sell. We can just let the bonds mature. Well, that's not going to get them out of jail. First of all, a lot of the bonds now, again, don't mature for 20 or 30 years. So, I mean, how can they let those mature? If they have to tighten, they can't wait 20 years to tighten. They got to tighten right now. But even if you take their short-term bonds, and about a third of the national debt, 5, 6 trillion or 7, whatever it is, matures in the next year. But even if the Fed doesn't sell that, if they just let it mature, well, now the Treasury has to sell it. They still have to find buyers, because if the Fed doesn't roll over the debt, the Treasury has to find another buyer for those bonds. We can't pay it off. I mean, how are we supposed to pay off $6 or $7 trillion in maturing debt? We can't. That's why it's a Ponzi scheme. We need more lenders to loan us the money. In fact, we need to borrow the money from the same people who loaned it to us in the first place. That's what we're counting on, right? But I think once interest rates start to rise, no one's going to want to buy the bonds. I mean, you can put a chart up there of interest rates, but you can see the yield on a 30-year treasury is just about 3%. On a 10-year, it's not even 2%. Once interest rates start to rise and people recognize that, no one is going to buy those bonds. And everybody who already owns those bonds is going to sell. So that's why the Fed can't exit. And in fact, I think that the next move from the Fed is not to reduce the $85 billion a month in quantitative easing, but to increase it. Because, you know, quantitative easing, or it's like a drug, right? And so the more quantitative easing the Fed puts into the economy, the more it has to do. Because the economy requires more. It's like building up a tolerance for heroin. You know, pretty soon you have to take more and more of it, right? That's what they tell me anyway. But if you want to maintain that high. So that's what you have to do with stimulus. Because as the stimulus starts to wear off, the hangover starts to set in. And that's what would happen. So now the Fed is going to have to increase the size of the stimulus. But what's ultimately going to bring an end to the party is inflation. And, of course, inflation is already here, right? Just the government does a pretty good job of lying about it. They use measures like the CPI that purport to measure inflation. But really, they're just designed by the government to hide the rate of inflation. Anybody that spends money knows that prices are rising much more than the 1% to 2% that the government claims. And by the way, if the government had an accurate measure of inflation, we would know that we were still in recession. And we are. We never got out of the recession. It only looks like there's no recession because the GDP is getting bigger because the deflator is too small. If the deflator were accurate, we would understand that the economy is shrinking. And that makes a lot more sense because people are disappearing from the labor market, right? It makes more sense that the economy is smaller today than that it's larger. So I think what's really happening is inflation is masquerading as economic growth because the statistics don't tell the full story. But eventually, prices are going to rise to the point where the Fed can't, with a straight face, pretend there's no. I mean, initially, as inflation gets above 2%, based on their numbers, they'll probably claim victory. They'll try to convince us that it's a good thing because, you know, at least they saved us from deflation, right, which is the worst thing that can happen, right? The cost of living goes down. That's the worst thing that can happen to you, is the things that you need to buy become less expensive. The Fed wants to make sure that we don't suffer that fate. They want to make sure that everything we need to buy gets. What they're going to do is they're going to claim victory. But, you know, eventually it's going to be too good thing. And the Fed is going to be placed in a position where it actually has to raise rates. It actually has to exit its monetary policy. But it can't. It can't exit. Because the minute it steps on the brake, this whole phony recovery implodes, right? The housing market comes back down. The stock market comes back down, And all the debt comes back to haunt us because now servicing that debt costs more money, but the assets are no longer rising. So the whole thing implodes. So the Fed can't do that. So it has to keep on inflating. It has to keep on making excuses, but it has to keep on inflating. But then, as bondholders around the world recognize that the Fed has been bluffing the whole time, that there's no exit strategy, then that puts even more pressure on the dollar and on the bond market. Now the Fed has to print even more money to buy up all the bonds that everybody is selling. But it's not just the treasuries or the mortgages. It's the corporate bonds. You know, junk bond yields right now are at a record low. I mean, junk bond yields now are about where treasuries used to be not too long ago. Of course, treasury debt is junk debt too, but nobody recognizes it. But once people realize how bad inflation is, they're not going to want to hold on to these low-yielding corporate bonds. Look at those Apple bonds that they just sold. What was it? What, 10-year bonds at 2%? Right? Who's going to want to hold on to those bonds when they realize inflation is 4, 5, 6%? And, of course, by the time the numbers say it's 4 or 5, 6%, maybe it's 15%. Because right now it's probably, you know, 7 to 10%, and the government claims it's 1 to 2%. So now the Fed's going to have to enlarge QE and start buying corporate bonds. The Fed's going to have to start buying muni bonds. The Fed's going to have to buy all the bonds. It's not going to be the buyer of last resort. It's going to be the buyer of only resort. That's the only way it can keep interest rates down. But the problem is the more money it prints to buy bonds, the less the bonds are worth because the bonds are simply IOUs for the money they're printing, which is losing value the more they print it. So at some point, there is going to be an inflection point, or the Fed is going to get to the point where it can't do it anymore. And it's going to have to make a choice. It's going to have to finally do the right thing after years of doing the wrong thing. It's going to have to let interest rates go up, and they're going to go way up because we waited so long. The longer we wait, the higher they're going to go. So the Fed's going to have to let interest rates go up. It's going to have to turn off the presses and just let the chips fall where they may. And, you know, as I said, it'll make 2008 look like a Sunday school picnic when that happens. But that's the good alternative. The bad alternative is that they realize how bad it's going to be and they just never stop. And then we basically OD on stimulus. We do the economic equivalent of an overdose. And that's where we get into hyperinflation, which maybe we'll talk about in the panel later. But that is the ultimate if the Fed doesn't do the right thing. And so, yeah, if we have runaway inflation, sure, the stock market's going to go up, but who cares? Doesn't matter if the stock market goes up. It doesn't matter if the real estate market goes up because it's not going to be going up as fast as the cost of living. The real stock market will be going down in terms of gold. In fact, it'll be going down in terms of food. It'll be going down in terms of energy. It'll be going down in terms of everything that you have to buy. So the real gains will not be there. It'll be an illusion. So one way or another, right, either nominal stock prices continue to rise, but they get outstripped by the cost of living, or the Fed does the right thing and stock prices collapse, which is what they would do if the Fed took away the punch bowl. But they don't want to do that for the same reason they didn't want to do it in 2006 or 2005 or 2004, because the political consequences of doing the right thing are too great, because then they have to admit what the problem is. They don't want to admit the problem, right? And the problem is that we collectively as a society, we spend too much, we borrow too much, we don't produce enough, we don't save enough. You know, the savings rate right now, this last month, we reported it last month, is now down to 2.6%. It's the lowest it's been since the fourth quarter of 2007. So our savings are going through the floor, and we keep on speculating in the stock market and the real estate. The government keeps on borrowing and spending money, and the imbalances that underlie our economy, these structural imbalances, get bigger and bigger and bigger. And the politicians don't want to level with the voters and tell them, look, you know, we promised too much. We can't deliver. Right? They just want to pretend that they can keep all these promises, and they want to try to do it by printing money. I know, am I running out of time? Oh, yeah, I keep hearing him fuddling. Normally there's like a clock here that counts down. And you can see, I just got this rustling going out over my shoulder.
Passive aggressive.
But anyway, so where was I? Yeah, so don't be fooled by all the happy talk and all the bullishness out there. Yeah, the market is rising, but it's rising for all the wrong reasons. It's the same reasons it rose in 2005 and 2006. We saw how badly that ended. And it would have ended even more badly had the government done the right thing. But they didn't. Instead of allowing the market to fix the mistakes that were made as a consequence of bad monetary policy, we simply have even worse monetary policy now. And if you can see all the damage the Fed did the last time around with 1% interest rates, you can only imagine how much more damage is being done now when interest rates are at zero. And remember, when under Alan Greenspan, we had 1% interest rate, but the Fed's balance sheet wasn't growing. The Fed wasn't monetizing all the debt. Now it's doing it, buying up all the mortgages, buying up all the treasuries. So monetary policy is far more aggressive now than anything that Greenspan would have contemplated. In fact, I think one thing that Ben Bernanke has accomplished is he's let Alan Greenspan off the hook because he's no longer the worst Fed chairman ever. The key is going to be, apparently, you know, Ben Bernanke is going to retire. He hopes he gets out of Dodge before this thing collapses. So we'll see his successor, what happens to that person. But, I mean, you know it's going to be more of the same policy. So you can't, you know, believe what you hear. When you go on television, you watch the financial experts. Remember, the guys that are telling you that everything is great are the same guys that were laughing at me back in 2006 and 2007 when I told them it wasn't great. They couldn't see the last crisis, right? And they're oblivious to this one because they never understood it. And the only bubble that they can detect is the gold market bubble. And that's the only market that's not in a bubble. You know, and I know I'll probably get to that in my workshop, but, you know, it's interesting. All these people that talk about a gold bubble, I've talked to a lot of them. None of them own any gold. They've watched it go from $260 an ounce to $1,900 and haven't bought a single ounce the entire time. And the minute it goes down, they say, I told you so. But, you know, the other thing, hardly anybody owns gold. I mean, if it was a bubble, we'd all own it. I mean, I go to talk to fund managers that have, you know, billions and billions of dollars under management. I ask them, do you own any gold? No. Own any gold stocks? No. See, it's the only bubble where nobody owns the asset. So it's a bubble in talk, right? So eventually, all the people that are saying gold's a bubble are going to start buying it. And when they're all in, then maybe it's a bubble. But I don't think we're anywhere near that. I guess that's it, right? All right, but I'm going to be here. Look, I got a booth. I got guys here from the Scottsdale office. We got a few of the brokers here from Scottsdale. I'll be at my booth all day tomorrow, so stop by. Again, I got the workshop, got a couple of panels. I think we have some of my books, too, at the booth. If you don't have any copies, I'll be able to autograph some. Thanks. You can bring that one.